It's that glorious time of the year when winged migrators drop out of the springtime sky to feed and rest as they push northward. Flocks of mallards twist and turn as they circle the freshly thawed wetland below. Sandhill cranes rejoice the seasonal change too, with some early birds already claiming their sections of marsh to nest. Looking up, flashes of white sail by in an orderly fashion. Tundra swans all the way from the Chesapeake Bay region. Their destination for today is right here in central Wisconsin. Their short stay will be filled with busyness as well as relaxation, bulking up for the next leg of their Arctic tundra nesting destination is number one. And there's plenty here for them to do just that. Aquatic vegetation, freshwater invertebrates, and insects will fuel this northward journey. A great horned owl incubating its clutch of eggs within a woodland next to the marsh watches this swan spectacle through the treetops. This apex predator has timed the arrival of its offspring to the marsh's bounty. Wetlands teeming with life as the owlets grow, well after the tundra swans are long gone. Bald eagles glide over the flocks. Their interest, like the owls, is not on the large swans, but all the other smaller critters scattered throughout and around the wetland. Tundra swans, with their large show of numbers, are not the first to arrive here. Trumpeter swans started showing up when the river running through these wetlands thawed out. They, of course, spent time in the river feeding and lounging, but still chose to hunker down on the frozen, snow-covered wetland to roost. not worrying about a distant lone coyote prowling the same wetlands. As warm weather opens the marshes, the trumpeters settle in. The trumpeters, of course, will mix with the tundra swans from time to time. But generally, find their own space where family members gather. Trumpeter swans are larger than tundras, but from a distance, they can be difficult to tell apart, especially if you can't hear their distinctive calls. Quite soon, though, the tundra swans will be gone. In their absence, many trumpeters will remain to begin nesting as fresh vegetation colors the marsh green. Last year's offspring must now be driven off to make room for this year's new batch of hatchlings. So after several days of wining and dining on the marsh's bounty, the tundra swans are feeling the positive effects. Their high energy level makes them a bit antsy, and scuffles about who's in charge and what they're in charge of escalates. As tensions ease towards the evening, the swans appear charged up and ready to go. Some just can't wait any longer, as the fired up flock reacts with excitement. As the sun disappears behind some clouds, the swan's ambitious chatter is heard throughout the wetlands. Thank you. morning sun again pokes through the clouds. The tundra swans are on their way. The next leg of their journey is spurred on by eagerness and favorable winds. Taking its cue, perhaps, from the sun, and navigating the nighttime sky while following other celestial signals. As trees take on their new summer look, and last year's cattails start filling in with fresh green growth, a pair of trumpeter swans, standing 4 feet tall and sporting wingspans of over 7 feet, settle upon a muskrat house to nest. Pen or female swan will add an egg every other day, while the cob, her partner, keeps a protective eye on the nest site and her. Once the clutch is complete, generally 4 to 6 eggs, she settles into the business of incubation. For the next 33 days or so, she will be responsible for most of the egg care, and the cob will be responsible for keeping the site free of intruders. Safe for the future hatchlings. As 48P and his mate settle into a long stretch of incubation, another trumpeter swan pair work to secure their section of wetland. They may not even nest, but still celebrate their bond. Meanwhile, among the lush stands of cattails, 48P and his mate have successfully graced the marsh with 5 new cygnets. "48P is the product of a trumpeter swan reintroduction program started in the late 1980s. Absent from the Midwest for most of the century, the plan was to eventually restore the trumpeter swan back into Wisconsin, Michigan, Iowa, Minnesota, Ohio, South Dakota, and Nebraska, as well as the Canadian province of Ontario. As time went on, 48P was eventually banded as a cygnet in August of 2012. Several years later, he fathered this family of 5, less than 100 miles north of where he was born. The swan recovery program went very well, so much so that in 2009, just 20 years after it began, trumpeter swans were taken off the endangered species list. The largest waterfowl species native to North America was making a comeback throughout the Midwest. The Pen and Cob keep a close eye on their new brood. A passing pair of trumpeters overhead are not welcome here. No harm done. So the family concentrates on what it came here to do: collect food. For the first few months after hatching, the cygnets rely on aquatic invertebrates and insects. High energy foods for strong growth. They also pick at easily accessible aquatic plants, such as duckweed. As they mature, they will feed on mostly plant material, but now test whatever looks edible. this afternoon feeding session soon runs its course. So the family heads for a favorite roost among the cattails. They settle in the brood, while the cob and pen keep watch. Later that day, after the cygnets were rested, some serious feeding took place that stretched into the evening. All sorts of plant material, along with small crustaceans, insects, small fish, and fish eggs, to name only a few, were being stirred up by the parents. Food, forced to the surface by the churning, was eagerly getting snatched up by the hungry cygnets. All these stirred up goodies, even a track, a red-winged blackbird. but there are also others watching intently. Snapping turtles striking at an unsuspecting cygnet from below. Great horned owl notices too. The threat from overhead is as dangerous as from below. On the edge of the marsh, where these swans nest, bald eagles have a clear view. And they have hungry mouths to feed. The water surface has plenty of worries for the swans also, as a sly, secretive mink might lurk within the cattails. All these threats aren't enough. A wily coyote patrols the shoreline. The swan parents surely have their work cut out for them, keeping the cygnets safe. Chances are, they will lose some of their brood, but they are also a protective force to be reckoned with. Large, aggressive birds, ready at a moment's notice to defend their young. Before you know it, summer transforms into autumn. And 48P and his partner have already led their brood into other wetlands, away from the nest. Frost has taken over, and many winged residents have already left, while some contemplate doing the same. Cold winds swirling the first snow flurries of the season. A hardy pair of trumpeter swans take it all in stride. Their ability to access food will have some bearing on just how far they might migrate, often seeking out open rivers to spend the winter, or moving southward until they find open water. As small flocks of tundra swans begin to drop in while migrating back to the Chesapeake Bay area, they sometimes mix with trumpeter swans, already feeding within these smaller wetlands. Under the watchful eye of an immature bald eagle, the trumpeters and tundras can be heard talking. They both know that the eagle poses little danger. So while we enjoy the quieter, more serene aspect of waterfowl migration, the real movement is playing out in the shallows of the Mississippi River. Swans, geese, ducks, coots, all following the river as they move southward. Family groups of tundra swans, with cygnets now nearly as large as their parents, drop into the flocks below. It is time to recharge once more, as their East Coast destination gets closer. And they just keep coming. Eagles are here in numbers too. Some of them are migrating somewhat also, following the masses southward. And all of them are focused on food. It might look a bit overwhelming, but the eagle's interest is on the smaller prey. And they love coots. But remember, once you catch something, you've got to be able to hang on to it. Conflicts, of course, are still taking place all around. For such a gregarious species, the tundra swans still like their space. Thank you. as the sun sets on the bluffs of the Mississippi. It ushers in more frigid air, and the flocks hunker down in response. The night ahead will be downright cold.